Good evening. On this, the 14th Sunday in Ordinary Time, we greet you and welcome you on this 4th of July weekend. Our Father Christopher Schaffer, Father Chris Schaffer, is our celebrant this evening, and we invite you to stand for the opening hymn, which will be sung by the soloist.
Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. with holy joy. For on those you have rescued from slavery to sin, you bestow eternal gladness. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
A reading from the book of the prophet Zechariah. Thus says the Lord, rejoice heartily, O daughter Zion. Shout for joy, O daughter Jerusalem. See, your king shall come to you. A just savior is he, meek and riding on an ass, on a colt, the foal of an ass. He shall banish the chariot from Ephraim and the horse from Jerusalem. The warrior's bow shall be banished, and he shall proclaim peace to the nations. His dominion shall be from sea to sea, and from the river to the ends of the earth. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will praise your name forever, my King and my God.
I will praise your name forever, my King and my God.
I will extol you, O my King and God, and I will bless your name forever and ever. Every day will I bless you, and I will praise your name forever and ever.
I will praise your name forever, my King.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and of great kindness. The Lord is good to all and compassionate toward all his works. Let all your works give you thanks, O Lord, and let your faithful ones bless you. Let them discourse of the glory of your kingdom and speak of your might.
I will praise your name forever, my King and my God.
The Lord is faithful in all his words and holy in all his works. The Lord lifts up all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down.
I will praise your name forever, my King and my God.
A reading from the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, you are not in the flesh. On the contrary, you are in the Spirit, if only the Spirit of God dwells in you. Whoever does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. If the Spirit of the one who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, the one who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also, through his Spirit that dwells in you. Consequently, brothers and sisters, we are not debtors to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. The word of the Lord.
Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. Alleluia. Alleluia. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to the Lord.
At that time, Jesus exclaimed, I give praise to you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth. For although you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned, you have revealed them to little ones. Yes, Father, such has been your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father. No one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son wishes to reveal him. Come to me, all you who labor and are burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart, and you will find rest for yourselves. For my yoke is easy, and my burden light. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus.
There is perhaps no more iconic an image that symbolizes America and its values as a Statue of Liberty. It's been standing on Ellis Island in New York Harbor since the late 19th century. And over the years, it has welcomed millions of immigrants into the United States, men, women, and children looking for a new life and opportunity. And on this 4th of July weekend, we'll no doubt hear any number of patriotic songs and speeches, and among them, we're likely going to hear references to a poem written by a woman named Emma Lazarus in 1883, which is now engraved at the base of the Statue of Liberty. And it's known as the New Colossus, and the most familiar part of it reads, "Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free. Send these, the homeless, tempest-tossed, to me." You know, it's been said that those words reinvented the statue's purpose from simply a monument to the principles of an elected government to a symbol of welcome and hope to the immigrants that come to our country and to all the outcast and downtrodden of the world. And certainly at a time when people were driven to seek out a better life, America for this powerful symbol that announced this is a place to find that refuge. Though we know from history it wasn't without a lot of hard work and great sacrifice. Because once that liberty was established, you know, we still have to be reminded how hard we must still work in order to maintain it. And when we're confronted with reality that we're not quite as far along as we would like, you know, even in some instances as we're seeing today, it can make us tired, it can make us frustrated, it can make us want to throw up our hands and even give up. You know, 20 years before that poem was written, the United States was in the middle of our Civil War, with seemingly no end in sight. And the nation, rightfully so, was war-weary. You know, not just physically tired, but morally and emotionally exhausted. You know, as we know, Abraham Lincoln was president at the time. And one day in 1863, he was out riding with a friend, Noah Brooks. And Brooks, knowing how much of a toll the war was taking on Lincoln, noticed that he was very tired. So he suggested that he take a brief rest when they got back to the White House. And Lincoln looked at him and he replied, "A rest. You know, I don't know about a rest. I suppose it's good for the body, but the tired part of me is inside and out of reach." You see, Lincoln was acknowledging a very important truth I think we probably all experience. You know, we all get tired from time to time, and there are many sources of our fatigue. In fact, physical fatigue may be the most harmless. But there's also that fatigue that comes from a stressed life. Fatigue that comes from worry, not just about the future, but perhaps even about the past. Fatigue that comes from always trying to be something that perhaps we are not. And in our quest to relieve our exhaustion and lift that burden, we so often neglect that very simple remedy that is given to us by Jesus today. And what he says is it's not unlike those words engraved at the Statue of Liberty. Give me your tired, your poor, your huddled masses, yearning to breathe free. Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and are burdened, and I will give you rest." And instead, as so often is the case, you know, we tend to turn to the world and seek the solutions that it offers. You know, get away, escape, take a pill to ease your nerves, take a drink to drown your sorrows, take a shot to kill the pain, get drunk, take drugs, sleep a lot, fill the emptiness with food or pleasure, fantasy, or other distractions. But the truth is, these things don't work, at least not for long. What we really need is time that is filled with a greater meaning and a greater purpose, a life that is saturated with the very grace of God. What we need, according to the beautiful paradox of the gospel today, is not to be free of a burden, but to take on a burden, to take on a different kind of burden, that is the yoke of Jesus Christ. A simple remedy. As he tells us today, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am meek and humble of heart. You see, this is an invitation for all who are going to listen and respond. To them, Jesus says, my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You see, it's not for the arrogant, it's not for the selfish, for the self-sufficient, those who won't listen, or for those who don't believe that life should entail any amount of struggle. But rather, this invitation is for the humble, the weak, the simple, those who recognize that the crosses of life lead to grace when carried with courage and dignity and faith. So Jesus extends this invitation to all those who are desperately trying to find God, to know that he exists and that he's real, those who are exhausted perhaps with the search for truth, desperately trying to be good enough, but finding the task impossible. See, Jesus is returning to the simplicity of God's original promise with his people, telling them that total reliance on him is all that we need, because he is faithful, and he will never abandon us, and he will never forsake us. So he tells us to remove the worldly burdens that weigh us down, which are really no different than the burdens that the people had 2,000 years ago. You know, concerns about their jobs, about their marriages, about money or health or children, security or old age, or a thousand other things. You know, Jesus' concern for our burdens is still as real as everything, as anything. But so is that rest that he offers. So Jesus tells us, remove those burdens of ours as if we're taking off a shirt and put on a yoke, which is a much lighter load, because the yoke of Jesus is in fact the very love of God. And that doesn't mean that it's always going to be easy to carry, but total reliance on God means following his commands, sometimes in ways that are very challenging. But we have to realize that the yoke of Jesus is laid upon us in love, and it's meant to be carried in love. But that's exactly what gives our lives the meaning and the purpose that we need to make even that very heaviest of burdens bearable. You know, today, Jesus is really making two main invitations. You know, first, that we unload all of our burdens upon him, and second, that we begin to free ourselves from all our unnecessary burdens. You know, first, to unload our burdens on him, prayer and worship are key. You know, every morning when we wake up, we should offer some prayers to God, offering him our challenges for the day ahead, asking for the grace to face them with strength and with courage. And then in the evening, our prayer should be a time to review the day and offer God our failures, asking him for the assurance that he's going to be with us yet again tomorrow. When we come and participate in the Mass, we have this opportunity to offer all of our prayers and all of our problems, all of our troubles to God, to lay them down before his altar, because we know that there we're going to find rest and refreshment, because we're uniting ourselves to his love and to his divine will. And even if in the course of our day it's just a moment we can do that, there's nothing like coming to him and laying down our burdens. then, as I said, second, we're invited to find a way to free ourselves from those little burdens, those unnecessary burdens that we might encounter in the future. You know, for so many of us, the greatest burden, you know, we say is, my life's so busy, too much stuff to do, not enough time to do it. But, you know, life's greatest burden is not a busy schedule. Rather, it's our constant engagement with the trivial and unimportant things in life. Our constant anxiety over the uncontrollable and the unpredictable. So the question really is, should I take on a burden? Or should I be yoked? But rather, who or what should I be yoked to? You see, Jesus doesn't want to remove all of our burdens so that we have nothing to carry. Rather, he wants to remove from us those burdens that drain our life from us, so we can place his own yoke on us, which is light and brings us joy. So we're called not only to find peace, refreshing, and rest for ourselves, but also to take upon ourselves the responsibility that Christian love entails. To live the kind of life in which others too may find God's joy and peace and grace. You see, Jesus' invitation today is an invitation to total reliance on him, especially in those moments when we feel the weight of our worries. And trusting him to refresh us and give us strength. And, you know, going back into history, I think one of the simplest models of someone being able to do this actually comes from a past president, yet another one, Dwight D. Eisenhower. You know, back in World War II, he was supreme commander of the Allied forces in Europe, and he knew the importance of every decision that he was making. A great deal of pressure. And we might ask, well, how did he deal with it? How did he find that inner rest that so many of us also seek? Well, he shared with his pastor once that he never carried his burden alone. He gave it to God. He understood very well Jesus' words, so much so that when the pressures became too great, the day would come to an end. And he would simply pray, Lord, with your grace, I've done the best that I can today. You take over till morning. Would that we could do the same.
To the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the people of our nation, as we we celebrate our nation's independence this weekend, may we recognize that true freedom comes from being able to use our liberties to help those less fortunate than ourselves. We pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For areas of our world ravaged by terrorism, war, conflict, and violence, may Jesus Christ, the King of Peace, bring true and lasting peace to hearts and nations. We pray to the Lord. For the youth of the world, may they remain steadfast in their pursuit of Jesus Christ and be encouraged and led by the example and guidance of faithful parents, teachers, and members of the church. We pray to the Lord. For those who are burdened by illness, anxiety, fear, or grief, may their hearts be lightened by our Lord, who carries them in their sorrows. We pray to the Lord. For the souls of all the faithful departed, especially Jeanette Donahue, may they know the mercy of Christ and rise with him to a new and eternal life. We pray to the Lord.
Almighty, eternal Father, we turn to you in humble, confident faith that you hear and answer all of our prayers. Accept all these needs that we lay at your feet this day and answer them all in accord with your most holy will. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy. And you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory." The mystery of faith. We proclaim your death, O Lord, and profess your resurrection until you come again. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself. Grant that we, who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one Spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, with St. Anne and with all the saints, on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May the sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and Bernard, our Bishop, his assistant Andrew, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There, we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Savior's command and form a divine teaching, we dare to say it. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy not in our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant you peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Grant us peace. Behold, come, who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only to say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Once again, as we prepare our hearts to receive our Lord Jesus Christ, the most holy Eucharist, following Mass today. At this time, let us express our desire to be united to our Lord by together making a spiritual communion. Lord Jesus Christ, I believe that you are in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you above all things, and I long for you in my soul. Since I cannot now receive you sacramentally, come at least spiritually into my heart. As though you have already come, I embrace you and unite myself entirely to you. Never permit me to be separated from you. Amen.
Thank you.
diminished by such great gifts, we may gain the prize of salvation and never cease to praise you. Through Christ our Lord. Just a reminder on the instructions for Holy Communion. Today, immediately following Mass, after I go to the sacristy to remove my chasuble, I'll return to the sanctuary to retrieve the Holy Eucharist and then head to the back of the church, the main entryway. At that time, the ushers will assist by dismissing each pew, starting from the back, working our way forward. At that time, you can come to receive the Eucharist prayerfully, and then you can exit out either side of the doors. Please note that as you walked in today, our ushers were handing out ballots for our pastoral council elections. If you have not yet picked one up, or you didn't get one, or didn't get a chance to vote, then please do so today. There is a box in the entryway you can place your completed ballots, as well as a basket to place used pencils. If you're joining us online this weekend and don't have a chance to pick up a physical ballot, you can look at two different ways to do that. You can either vote online by calling or sending an email to the parish office, and then we'll send you a link to that website. Or you can call the office and we can send you a physical ballot itself. More information can be found on our parish website or by calling the parish office. And then finally, certainly I'd like to wish everyone a very happy and healthy 4th of July weekend. Pray that everyone is staying cool. I know we're probably here glistening a little bit here in the church this evening. I know I am, so we pray that God will grant some coolness and refreshment, just as he promises us today, right? Some rest and refreshment, well-deserved, and a way to glorify God in his goodness. And so as we conclude our Mass then today, let us turn to our Blessed Mother. Let us ask her intercession for ourselves and all of our needs as we pray. Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God. Yeah.